Let's start. The talk is about, let's shrink this, fully zoneless high performance in post-IV. And I skip the agenda. I will quickly tell you that I did a lot of work on reactive component state, which is basically a fundamental piece to get this high performance thing. Because if you go zoneless, you immediately need some component level state management. This state management reshaped a very unstructured way of coding in a reactive style to a reactive style to a performant reactive style. And you can find the package online under rxangular/state. And here is a link to the beautiful docs. And as I have no time, I will switch to rendering in Angular. And I will first start about template rendering and the component tree and how it works. And this is a mock-up that shows a really small app with a side menu and a list and the application ref as a blue box at the top. And this is how it looks in a component tree structure. And if we call application ref tick in a default Angular application, what happens is that Angular renders component, then its child component, then its child components, and then its child components. And this is the way it does it by default, which is not really performant because re-rendering every time everything for one single change is not cool. So therefore, there is the on push change detection on push. And here on this very small component with this gray triangle, I apply change detection on push. So if we call application ref tick again, it re-renders the application container, and then it comes to this component that has the on push set, and it evaluates if the previous value passed to this component is equal to the current value that is passed to component. If it is the same value, we will not render the whole tree below this on push, and we will go on with all the other components that either have new changes or no change detection on push set. Well, a lot of people say that's the solution to get performant Angular applications. Just use the async pipe and on push everywhere. And for sure, you can get quite far with this approach. But as we know from practice, there is a bunch of applications out there that are really slow because they suffer from this bad rendering performance. So first of all, let me clarify that even if you put everything on change detection on push, maybe you forget it somewhere. So if you want to introduce a change to this purple component, in reality, maybe you forgot to set change detection on push somewhere. You can, of course, avoid to forget it by implementing a linter rule, but even then, you still could have some third-party components that don't have it, or if this is also not the case, you still render from the very component up to the top and down the whole path to this very component as dirty and re-render it, even if you only introduce a single change in this purple thing. Let me quickly introduce myself. My name is Michael Latke. I do custom tailored training and consulting in Angular RxJS and all the surrounding ecosystem like Ionic and friends. So if you like what I do, feel free to book my workshops. But how to fix this over-rendering is the question. And let me tell you, we will fix it in a brilliant way. First of all the solutions that I present here are present under another package that focuses on rendering, not local state management. This package is called rxangular/template. And there you will get high performance rendering. In fact, you will get the performance of a zone-less application within a zone-full Angular application. This is pretty awesome. I have a couple of things that are included in this package, but I want to start with two things, the push pipe and the let directive, which is the first minimal tool set that I came up with. What is the push pipe? The push pipe is identical to the async pipe, just with 10 times more performance. And then we have a directive, the Rx let directive, which you see down here that takes an observable and binds the observable context to a template without displaying and hiding it, which we know from this ugly ng-if hack. Let me quickly show you how this looks. I have a demo application running here. And in this case, if I click the next button, we see a stream that presents bullish values, true or false. This here is done over the async pipe. And this here is done over the ng-ifhack. If I click next and the value changes to false, as we can see, only the async pipe is visible because the ng-ifhack that takes an observable has this show and hide the template over the ng-if logic. So therefore, we have this flickery behavior, which is really annoying. So the first thing that I want to demo is, let me quickly close other tabs. Where is the demo? Here. We see the async pipe and we see this ng-ifhack. So first, let me prove that the push pipe also works by putting the push pipe here and quickly press the button. And we see the push pipe also works. And then I go back and I will refactor the ng-ifhack here with the rxlet directive. The rxlet directive by default takes an observable and then projects the incoming values of this observable to a variable that is called value here. If the observable context errors or completes, I can also get hold of those values as well as of the suspense state. And then I could display the values here and they would not flicker. If I do this, we see now we have always both values here and this ugly flickering is gone. As this is a bit clumsy, let me add another thing, let me add templates that I can provide for every state the reactive context can have, and the reactive context is the next value or the next values, the error and the complete, as well as the suspense state. The suspense state is when you bind an observable which never emitted a value or which did not emit a value yet, so it is not, still in suspense. And then you can provide some templates where you have the error here visible, the complete, or for the suspense state, you can have some ghost elements. Let me quickly demonstrate it. Here we are in the suspense state. We see the ghost elements, nothing happens. Then maybe you bind an HTTP request. The HTTP request enters and we see the value of the HTTP request. If the HTTP request would error, which I can simulate here, we could display another template. Of course, this is a little bit ugly, so we have also way nicer demos how you can handle those things in our repository demo page. Feel free to check it out and see the abilities that you can do with the rxlet directive by default. I can tell you, you will save a bunch of HTML and ng-ifhackery. The next thing in this presentation is rendering strategies. As we provide rendering strategies and all our code, as well as the state management code for imperative as well as reactive users, we have two things. We have the reactive strategies and the imperative rendering methods. So what are those methods? We have quite a couple of them, but today I want to only talk about the global strategy and the local strategy. So how can I apply strategies? At the moment, we can apply it by passing a parameter to the push pipe or a parameter to the let directive, which helps us to configure a rendering method specifically to this single push pipe. Of course, in the next releases, we will also provide a way to configure these rendering strategies globally for your whole application, which is pretty cool. Let's start with the global strategy. The global strategy is either mark4check or mark30. We switched from mark4check to mark30 because it also works zoneless. So what does mark30 do, the Theta mark30 released under Ivy? Well, if you introduce a change to a component here, it goes all the way up as mark30 would do, mark the component path as dirty, which you see with these red triangles, and then it will re-render the full component tree and all its child components. Same as the mark4check would do from the async pipe. But it works for zoneless applications too. The downside, as we already know, we have this unnecessary rendering of the full component tree up to the very top and then down again, which is not really cool. I can quickly demo this rendering by switching to our coalescing thing, and I can show you if I switch to the native or the global strategy, we re-render the full application. As you can see, those numbers here, those are renderings of the components, and you see the full application re-renders, which is not really cool. So therefore, we introduced a second strategy, the local strategy, which is the fundamental piece that we used to get this performance. The local strategy exists, I guess, since the first version of Angular, and under Ivy, they also introduced another flavor of this method, the tether detect changes flavor, which is not bound to the change detector ref, but you can pass a component that you want to render. Okay, what does the local strategy do? If you call detect changes in a component, it will re-render the component, only this very component and its children and nothing else, which is a lot better than before. The only problem is, if we would directly use change detection, detect changes, we would run into problems. We would over-render pretty hard. Maybe you saw the talk 2 years ago from Sander on ngVikings. He talked about zoneless applications and local change detection, and he showed that you have a very bad performance impact if you not really take care. And back then, there was no chance to figure out how to make it really, really performant. So at the moment, with this really small example, we have 12 re-renderings for one single change in the UI, which is pretty awful. Let me quickly show you that it is awful. And I switch to the default local. And if I click this button now, where I have to switch. And now the local is working. So if I click this button now, we see only this very component re-renders and not all the rest of the application. But if I click the button, look at the number 16, 22, 82. So a lot of re-renderings are present when we just use it by default. And this is really not good. So let me show you how we fixed those problems under rxAngular/template. We used scheduling, so let me quickly show you some flame charts and introduce a task. And this task here is, there is no scheduling. So let me quickly talk about scheduling. Well, scheduling is triggering some work. This is the trigger. In our case, it was a button click. And then we have work that should get scheduled. And this is this XXXXX function that internally calls detect changes. And scheduling means that we use a trigger to schedule work to another point in your browser event loop. And in this case, we use the animation frame to schedule it, which brings also very cool performance features. And it lands also right before the browser paint event. This is this green dashed line here that you can see. So this is the optimum moment to render something that the user should see, or to introduce some work that the user should see. You can use a couple of different rendering strategies. And here I displayed nearly all of them. Also the dark blue ones, which are the post-task scheduling APIs, which is not released yet, only present in Canary Chrome, but it also works with our library already. So scheduling, we have now a very rough concept of scheduling. Let me talk about coalescing. Coalescing means grouping multiple events into one. And our multiple events are render calls. So what we could do is we could schedule a render call over a micro task, which basically is code that happens immediately after our synchronous code is done. And with this trick, we could say, okay, all the render calls get now passed to a function that schedules those render calls to a micro task. And then we can say, we use this small time frame of a micro task and coalesce all those changes within the synchronous code together into one. And therefore, we can get this really, really cool performance locally. As we can see, we call it three times, we schedule all the three times, we use coalescing, And then it only renders one single time, which is amazing. Let me prove to you that this is possible. Here we have the default local, which renders a million times. I don't know. And now I go to local and I click it, and there is only one single rendering present here in this component, and the rest of the application is untouched, which is really, really awesome. Let me switch back because time is short in this 20-minute talk and show you the progress. So we went down from 12 re-renderings with this very small example here to one re-rendering, and we went from a blocking UI to a non-blocking UI. How? We used change detection, detect changes, which does not render the full component tree up and down again, so we save a lot of components that did not get re-rendered. We used coalescing to go down from 12 to 4, and then we used a really cool technique where we scoped coalescing to a components template or class instance, and this was the trick how we could go down to a single rendering per component. Also, non-blocking UIs are introduced by using different scheduling methods and also chunk our rendering into different pieces. The next thing is the viewport priority, and this is something that I want to demo directly. So let's imagine you have a component here, and this component receives some updates, which I simulate here over this button click, and you see that the number here increases when I click the button. So some changes that are introduced to your application. We, of course, don't render the whole application, and this is really, really good, but what if we would scroll out of the visible context? What if we don't see the component that we re-render? Do we really want to re-render the whole application again? Of course not. So what we did is we introduced viewport observers that tells you if your component is visible currently on your screen or not. And if not, it will not re-render. So I click this count up button and nothing happens. Pretty cool. So you will say you will lose state, because when you scroll back in and you see it, then all the changes in between are lost. Well, we did solve those problems in two things. First of all, our component state management, Rx Angular slash state, has all the changes always hot. So we are not dependent on our state composition by the template, which most other solutions where you use the async pipe are. Second, if I increment to 50 and I scroll up, and I click it two times and I scroll in, we trigger change detection when we enter the screen, and then we see the last number, 25. Imagine how cool this is, yeah? You have a real-time application, a really big application with a lot of charts and whatever, and you get a lot of automated changes because it is real-time, and everything that is not visible will stop rendering. No changes, no traffic, your computer can chill, and if you see them again, you have the changes rendered again. Pretty, pretty cool. Let's go further and see if I have enough time. Nearly no time left. There is a last thing. It takes 1 minute to demo. A lot of people try to get rid of this over-rendering by tricking zone. And Angular by default, this is a button click of a Hello World example with just the button in the console log. And this happens when you click this button in a native Angular application. So what many people do is they try to trick zone by using run outside of zone. And as you can see, the amount of work that your browser needs to do is less than half. I guess it is somewhere around a third. And what we did is we did something really cool. We don't work with zone and use run outside of zone. Our whole application and all the two packages, Rx Angular State and Rx Angular Template, are zone agnostic, which means we don't care if you use zone or if you don't use zone, you will always get the best performance. Look here, this is the diff to the run outside of zone. This is the smallest amount of work that your browser could do. This is vanilla execution. No zone, no Angular interference, nothing. This is the fastest thing how you can render something. And To demonstrate you that all this is working, I will open up two applications. I will refresh this page here. There is Noop and there is Zone.js. So this is a Zone full application. And if I click this input box here, you see that every single key down re-renders the full application because the events are patched by Zone. So if I go here and I apply our unpatch directive and do this search type stuff again. Let me quickly wait until it is re-rendered. Then it is not working. I did not import it in this demo. Okay, so I will do a very quick test if it works. Otherwise, I'm done with the presentation and skip. I have to go here and say unpatch event module. And if I import it in my application and I refresh the page again, it is still not working. Okay, so let's skip this demo. Let's go to another demo where we run in Noop Zone. We see this because Zone is Noop and it is working. We can navigate for and back. We can also search here for some things. We can clear this stuff and we can navigate around. So this whole application works completely zone-less. Not only zone-less, but also with way better rendering performance and non-blocking UI. That's, I guess, it. Let me do a shout out to all amazing contributors of the RX Angular package or the packages of RX Angular. There are a bunch of cool people in the team. You should check out the repository. Here a quick reminder, I have performance rendering under RX Angular /template, our local state management, which is lazy and has all the tricks to leverage the power of this new template rendering strategies is RX Angular /state. I was very happy to give this talk here. If you have any other questions, ping me on Twitter, send me an email. You can also book my workshops, of course, and you should definitely give us a star on GitHub to motivate the cool core team of RX Angular.